Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tom Banchoff. I'm the Vice President for Global Engagement here at Georgetown and a professor in our School of Foreign Service. It's not my phone. That's good. I'm really delighted to welcome you on behalf of our entire university community here to Historic Riggs Library and to a celebration of this new and important book, The Great Surge, The Ascent of the Developing World, by our friend and colleague Steve Radelet. Steve, as many of you know, is one of the world's leading experts on development here at Georgetown. He holds the Donald F. McHenry Chair in Global Human Development and serves as director of the Global Human Development Program in our School of Foreign Service. He joined our faculty in Georgetown here in 2012 after serving as chief economist at USAID and as a senior advisor for then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton on issues of development. Now, Steve has authored quite a range of impressive publications as author, co-author, editor, and co-editor. This one is particularly important, as you'll learn today. The Great Surge makes a powerful argument about what is going right in the world of development. While he does not gloss over the trenchant problems that poor countries face, he draws our attention to their considerable successes, often unnoticed and certainly underappreciated, and the lessons they hold for the future. If you don't believe me, here's a quote from Bono on the book jacket. With the airwaves filled with news of insurrection, desperation, and still stubborn diseases, this book jars you out of a cliched response. With his typical care and detail, Radelet describes humanity's greatest hits over the last 20 years. Never have we lived in a time when so many are doing so well. The job surely isn't done, but these pages provide evidence that the job can be done if we choose to do it. Humanity's greatest hits. All right, that's hard to top. And this is just one of several great testimonials that are accompanying the release of this book. Others include George Soros and Francis Fukuyama. Steve, we look forward to learning more about your book and your findings. You'll then be joined by our colleague, Dr. Joel Hellman, the new dean of our School of Foreign Service, for an onstage conversation about the themes of the book that we will then open up to the audience here. There's really no one better suited for this role than Joel, who's just entering the room and joins us from a leadership position. Joel, come right up front here. At the World Bank, where he served as chief institutional economist, the culmination of a decades-long career as a prominent development scholar and practitioner. Now, before I turn things over to Steve, just a word about the wider university context for this gathering and our work at Georgetown on development more broadly. The study of development, of global development, is a priority not just within SFS, but also across the entire university. As a Catholic and Jesuit institution committed to the pursuit of social justice, Georgetown is home to a range of development programs with professionals, scholars, and practitioners working on problems of poverty and inequality in their political, economic, social, legal, and other dimensions. And as I hope many of you are aware, the development theme has featured prominently in the Global Futures Initiative, a two-year university-wide exploration of four issues critical to the future of humanity: development, governance, security, and the environment. Last semester, we hosted two lectures by Jim Kim, and Joel gave the inaugural Global Futures lecture this semester on failed states as a challenge both for development and for global governance. Steve, the initiative is delighted to serve as one of the sponsors for today's event. Without any further delay, please join me in welcoming Steve Radelet to the podium.
Thank you, Tom. Thanks, everybody, for being here. I really appreciate you coming out on such a beautiful day. You've all got better things to do than being here, but it's nice to see you all here. I want to start. This is actually the first event that I have had since the book was released last Tuesday. So I want to start with giving some recognition and some thank yous to a lot of people that have been involved here. Carol Lancaster has been on my mind quite a bit, you know, in the last week. She is a major force that looms large over everything that I do, and was a big part of this book and part of the inspiration. And when I came to Georgetown, encouraged me to do this. So Carol is a big part of this. And the first thing that Carol Lancaster did was point me to Carol Sargent, who's our director of publications, who helped me get this organized and get a proposal written and lined us up with the publisher and all of that. And this honestly could not have been done without Carol's work. I want to thank Tom for his support and making me part of the Global Futures event, and for Joel and his participation here today, and others in his office, Claire and Gail Griffith and others that have been very supportive. I want to particularly thank, and I am very honored that Don McHenry is here with us today, who my chair is named after, after he's retired recently from his many, many years of service at Georgetown. He was the U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations and served his country for a long time, and then served Georgetown and our community for a very long time. And I'm proud to know him and incredibly proud to have my position named after him. I also want to thank my colleagues, my faculty colleagues at the GHD program, especially Gillette Hall, who's with us today, and many others who have contributed to making this happen, and my students, who correct all my mistakes on a regular basis, whether I ask them to or not. They make it their business to correct little flaws that seem to get in the way. And in particular, Anna Bonfort, who I don't think is here today, one of our alums, was my research assistant that got this off the ground, along with Mallory Plax and Taylor Salisbury and Val Tockenberg and Lauren Cork in the back, is picking up some of that work today. And I want to thank Janice. Where's Janice? Janice is in the back. Janice did all the work here to make this event happen, along with Kyle. And I want to thank Indica for her support as well. But most importantly, I want to thank my wife, Carrie, my best friend and partner, who is here with us today, who put up with a lot to make this a lot to make this happen, a real lot. And she's read the book almost as many times as I have, and she keeps saying, okay, well, enough already. But she also has corrected a lot of the mistakes. So thank you all for being so supportive. I'm here to talk about some of the greatest achievements in human history, but I'm also here to throw down a challenge to all of us. And the challenge is basically whether or not we can make the choices and the sacrifices and the investments to keep some of these greatest changes in human history going for the next 20 years. And I'm not sure that we can. This book has three parts, and I'm actually going to talk mostly today about the third part, which I mostly don't get to do because I'm usually cut off or I run out of time before I get to the third part. The first part actually describes these great changes over the last 25 years, and we'll look at them very briefly. The second part is my story as to why that happened, and I'm going to go through that very briefly, too. I'm going to do the first two-thirds of the book in about 5 minutes here, I think, or maybe six. The third part of the book is, what about the future? And can some of these great trends in poverty reduction and improvements in human health and improvements in education and access to new opportunities for girls and women be continued in the decades to come? And that's what I want to talk about today, because the answer is unclear. I think it can, but I'm not sure it will. But that's what I want to get to today. So let's start by just looking quickly at some of the great changes in the world in the last 25 years. We live at a time of the greatest progress among the global poor in human history. There is no other time in history than the last 25 years where we have made more progress in reducing poverty, increasing incomes in the world's poorest countries, improving health, increasing access to education, reducing conflict, spreading democracy, and improving governance. There's really no other time. It's not even close, actually. Very few people are aware of the magnitude of these changes. And as a result that we're unaware of them, I think we're at risk of not doing what needs to be done to continue this great progress. But let me make my case rather quickly. These numbers show the decline in global poverty just in the last 25 years. To put them in context, you have to recognize that from the beginning of human history, the number of extremely poor people rose along with human population. More people on the planet, more and more of us were extremely poor. And by most estimates, in 1820, about 90% of the world's population was living in what we would today call extreme poverty. So the number was always rising. And it rose and rose and rose
and then flattened off in the 1980s and 90s, and then for the first time in history it began to fall, and it fell like a brick. These numbers on the red are the number of people living in extreme poverty, under $1.90 a day. In 1993, there were about 2 billion people living under $1.90 a day, extreme poverty. Just 19 years later, in 2012, we were down to 900 million people. Been cut in half in less than 20 years after rising from the beginning of time. About half of that progress is due to China, not surprisingly, but the other half is due to about 60 other countries around the world that have now seen the number of extreme poor fall. The blue line is the share of people living in poverty, and that has fallen from 40% to 13% in just 2 decades. Nothing like this, pretty obviously, has ever happened before in human history. That's poverty. This is health. This is the share of children that die before their fifth birthday. In 1960, 22% of children in developing countries did not live to their fifth birthday, if you can imagine. It's unacceptable, totally unimaginable, but that's what it was. Today, we're down to about 5%, which frankly is still unacceptable. But the drop from 22% of children dying to 5% means that 17 out of every 100 children that would have died just a couple of decades ago now live. And it's because of vaccinations, it's because of oral rehydration, it's because of building better health systems. And here's a remarkable fact. Most of these developments happen less, have made less progress in countries that are poorly governed, in dictatorships and other countries. The child mortality rate has fallen in every single country in the world where data are available since 1980. Every single one, there are no exceptions. There's nothing else like that that has improved in every single country in the world. But child death has done that. That, I think, is actually one of the most important changes and greatest achievements in human history. Hardly anybody knows that it's happening. So that's on health. This is also on health. This is life expectancy growing on the left side from 50 years in 1965 to 65 years. People are living one-third longer lives in developing countries. This is education. The gold bar is the number of years of education in all adults. That grew from 3.5 years in 1970 to 7 years in 2010. That is, the number of years of schooling that the average adult has doubled since 1970, from 3.5 to 7. Still not enough, but it's doubled in just a few decades. The blue bar is for men. It's gone from 4 years of education to 7.6. The red bar is for women, 2.7 to 6.5 years of education. The biggest gains have been for women. Women are finally catching up in terms of access to education. There's still a gap. It's a smaller gap. But we've gone from girls, from less than 50% of girls completing primary school just a couple of decades ago to 85% completing primary school today. So girls are getting much more access to education. Incomes are growing. This is just a simple graph of the average GDP per capita of in developing countries around the world. And you can see that GDP per capita, which is an approximation for average income, leveled off for 20 years between the mid-70s and the mid-90s. But since the mid-90s, it's really accelerated. And average incomes in developing countries around the world have doubled, excluding China. Excluding China, average incomes have doubled in real terms in just the last 20 years. Democracy. This is the number of democracies in developing countries. In the 1980s, there were just 17 countries, developing countries, that could be considered democracies. Today, that number is just under 60. And we're at a period where there are some countries falling back in democracy: Venezuela, Russia, Thailand after its coup. But we had Myanmar last week have its most successful elections, and it looks like finally the generals are going to step aside and let people choose their own leaders. Just a few months ago, Nigeria, of all places, had elections in which the opposition party actually won, and the leading party handed over peacefully power to an opposition party. Never happened before. Last year, a furniture maker in Indonesia, Joko Widodo, won an election over Suharto's former brother-in-law. I lived in Indonesia in the early 90s. Joe lived there more recently. If someone would have told me then what had happened last year, I would have said, "You are crazy." No furniture maker is going to beat Suharto's son-in-law in an election. It's never going to happen. It did last year. So we're having this surge towards democracy. All of Latin America, with a few exceptions, has now become democracies. Much of Asia and about half of sub-Saharan Africa has become democracy. And as part of that, conflict has fallen. This is the number of civil wars in developing countries. Nobody believes this. because we read about the tragic wars, obviously in Syria, in South Sudan, and other places. And as tragic as those are, and as much as they deserve our attention, rightly so, there are only about half as many civil wars in developing countries today as there were in the 1980s, when all of Central America was in flames, when all of Southern Africa was at war with each other in the last days of apartheid, when Southeast Asia was still reeling from the aftermath of the Vietnam War and the killing fields in Cambodia, plus all of the violence that was in the Middle East at that point, much of it that continues today in different forms. But there are far fewer wars in developing countries than there were today. Battle deaths in developing countries have fallen even sharper by about 75% in the last three decades. Steven Pinker, a psychologist up at Harvard, wrote a book, The Better Angels of Our Nature, and it looks at violence around the world for the last 500 years, as much data as can be found, and he concludes pretty clearly that we live in the most peaceful time in world history. It's hard to imagine that, but it is actually true. At least that's what the data tell us, and it's true in developing countries as well. But with all this good progress going on, there are still a lot of people left behind. This is the same average income graph in developing countries where incomes have doubled for the average country. These are the countries, the blue are the countries that have grown the fastest, the developing countries that have grown the fastest since 1960, 25 of them. And for those countries, mostly in East Asia and a few others, Botswana and Costa Rica and a few others, Mauritius, incomes have gone up by a factor of six since 1960, which is beyond imagination that people today, the average person in those 25 countries is has six times higher income than their grandparents did. But at the same time, along that great transformation in those countries, we live at a time where 25 other developing countries, represented by that line, have had zero income growth. Same world, same technology, same ideas, same global context, and we have 25 countries with the greatest progress ever alongside 25 other developing countries that are not making any progress at all. That's one of the great challenges in development. So that's what has happened. That's the first third of the book. And there's lots more on famine and hunger and access to water and all kinds of other things. Why has that happened? I'm not going to say much about it today because I could talk for hours about this. But basically, three big forces came along to undergird these changes in the 1990s. One was the end of the Cold War and the demise of the Soviet Union, which ended a lot of conflicts around the world, which led to a change in ideas towards more market-based capitalism and liberal democracies around the world. And it led to much greater connections in a more peaceful way that developing countries finally were out of the shackles of both colonialism and then the Cold War to make their own decisions and better be in charge of their own destiny. So the end of the Cold War was a big part of that. And China, the emergence of China, being the cornerstone of those big changes around the almost complete demise of communism. Not quite, but almost. The second big force was global integration and technology. I don't think this progress would have happened without a more integrated world in trade and finance, but also the exchange of ideas. The exchange of ideas around democracy, around markets, and the technologies that came with this. One of the best examples in my book on globalization is vaccines. You cannot get child vaccines from the factories in Indiana to a village in outer Mongolia without businesses working together with the United Nations and aid agencies and local governments and civil society groups in an integrated way. And those vaccines do not get from one side of the world to the other without global integration. And we've seen incredible technological advances in health, in agriculture, in communication technology, in shipping containers, and all kinds of other things that have created opportunities for developing countries to move forward. And the third big force was leadership in developing countries, a new group of leaders that came to the fore, people like Nelson Mandela, more recently Ellen Johnson Sirleaf in Liberia, and leaders in the political realm, the business realm, civil society, and others that took charge and really led their countries forward. Good governance is at the core of this, and while governance is not great in many developing countries, it is far better than it was 30 years ago in about two-thirds of developing countries, not all. And where leaders like Nelson Mandela came forward, countries made progress. Where leaders like Robert Mugabe consolidated power, they did not go forward. And I think that goes a long way to distinguish those that have gone forward from those that have not. There's a lot more to unpack in there. There's a fourth force that played a secondary role, and that's foreign assistance. And there's lots of debate about it. I have a whole chapter in it. But basically, the bottom line is that foreign assistance has saved millions of lives. There's really no doubt about that over the last 30 years in HIV/AIDS, malaria programs, immunizations, as I've already mentioned, and many other disease-fighting apparatuses, which wouldn't happen without foreign aid. The evidence also suggests that aid has modestly accelerated economic growth, and more recent evidence also suggests that it is helpful in consolidating the shift towards democracy. So there's a whole chapter on foreign aid, but I don't want this talk to just get hung up on foreign aid. So now we're two-thirds of the way through the book. But now I want to talk about the part that I almost never get to talk about, because usually by this point, either I'm way over time or I'm interrupted and everything else. And even here with our time, I'm gonna cut this shorter than it deserves. But most of my students, and actually my students have heard all of this before about 20 times. So at this point, they're all like, oh my God, tell me something new, please. So that's the other reason why I wanted to move ahead on this. This is the greatest progress so far in developing countries, but it is only 25 years. And from any development perspective, that's not very long. These gains are very fragile. They are not solidified yet. The institutions are not yet in place to make sure that this progress is going to happen in and of themselves. So it is all at risk. And so it raises the very big question, can this continue? Can this great progress continue where we continue to decrease poverty and lift more people out of destitution? Can we continue to combat child health? Can we continue to give girls and women more access to economic opportunities and educational opportunities? Can we solidify and deepen democracy? And can we figure out and strengthen our systems of global governance to make the world a better place and to face some of the great challenges that we face? I'm not sure. I thought hard about what to do with this book and whether to predict a future, and I thought that would be a pretty stupid thing to do, because no matter what I predicted, it would be wrong. So I don't predict a future. I lay out three possible scenarios, any of which I think are actually possible in terms of what might happen in the next 20 years or so in terms of the world's poorest countries. The first scenario is that this progress continues, that all of these gains that have been achieved over the last 20 years continue with some setbacks, with bumps on the road. Some countries might actually not make much progress. Others might. Some areas might advance more than others. So not perfectly smoothly, just like over the last 25 years, it's hardly been smooth. But it is certainly feasible that that can happen. And that, not just because we like to take lines and continue them going up, but because the changes that are underneath this great transformation are pretty fundamental. They're not transitory. This is not about commodity prices. This is about institutions changing. This is about ideas changing. This is about people getting more skills. This is about women getting more opportunities in the workforce. This is about systems of governance getting better. And those are fundamental changes that do create the foundation for this to continue. And if they can continue without going backwards, then I think we can see average incomes doubling again in developing countries over the next 20 years, so that they would be four times higher than they were in the 1990s. That is perfectly feasible. It requires GDP per capita growth of 3%. That's what it requires for the next 20 to 25 years, and incomes will double again and be four times higher than they used to be. That's not a super, super high growth rate. It's a solid one, but not a super high one. If that happens, 700 million people could be lifted out of extreme poverty, another 700 million. We may not eliminate or eradicate extreme poverty, but we can come pretty close. Infant deaths would continue to fall, life expectancy would grow, people would live longer and fuller lives. Three quarters of adults would have secondary education, including an equal share for women, finally. Democracy could continue to deepen and spread. And if this happens, the world is going to be a much safer and much better place, as it is, I think, today than it was 25 or 30 years ago. All of that is perfectly feasible. I'm not sure if it's going to happen. That's one scenario. A second is that this progress is diminished and it stalls, that we've basically reached where we're going to reach. And some countries might continue to go forward. China, even though it's slowing down, probably is going to continue to progress. But it could be that other countries really do slow down and things get in the way. The global economy is not yet fully recovered from the financial crisis, and some people like Larry Summers think it may not ever recover to the same growth rate that it did. He writes a lot about what he calls secular stagnation, in which the world's richest countries grow much more slowly than they used to. And if that happens, global growth could really slow, including in developing countries. We've seen the growth in China and slowing, in India slowing not quite as much. Brazil has slowed down quite a lot. That has knock-on effects on the other developing countries that trade with them if it continues for a long time. Although this is not a commodity price boom, the commodity price super cycle is over, and that's putting a lot of pressure on developing countries in terms of their revenue base and employment opportunities. That could slow things down. A lot of people think that technology is now replacing low-wage manufacturing jobs, and that the opportunities that were there for people to get jobs in manufacturing may not be there in the future. Democracy is in retreat in some countries. Russia has invaded Ukraine. China is rattling its sabers on the islands in the South China Sea in a way that it has not done in the last 30 years. It is finally pushing on external borders and raising the specter of cross-border violence in a way that hasn't been there in many decades. And the United States is not exactly jumping up to the forefront and leading on some of the world's biggest problems. So all of that could mean that the rate of progress could slow down very, very substantially. We might still see some progress, but not nearly as much as we've seen here. That's the second scenario. The third is that it actually all goes backwards, basically because there's too much pressure on the planet. We go from 7 billion people today to 9 billion in a couple of decades, and 10 billion by the end of the century. We have obviously climate change, which most developing countries had almost nothing to do with, and yet they will bear the greatest burden, and they are the most fragile, and they stand to lose the most from climate change if something is not done. Resource demand is growing. One of the flip side of incomes growing as fast as it has is that there are more people with higher incomes who are demanding more goods and services. Of course they are, just like we do. Better food, more food, better housing, and all that's good, but it puts a lot of pressure on resources. Disease could be growing. We've seen SARS, H1N1, the spread of the Ebola virus. A lot of people worry about what's the next Ebola. A lot of people worry about antimicrobial resistance growing and antibiotics losing their steam. If that happens, a lot of these health gains could be reversed very, very quickly. And of course, if any of that begins to happen the way I just described it, there will almost certainly be a rise in conflict. With people fighting over control of natural resources, over control of water, over control of fertile lands. Most wars have been fought over control over land and other resources, and if those become more important in the future, we could see a return to conflict. If that happens, things could go backwards in a hurry, and it could easily happen. So, which one will it be? I don't know. I don't have any idea. And the reason I don't have any idea is because none of those outcomes are fated. Those outcomes will be determined by decisions and choices that we make, individually, collectively, and as societies, and as the world. Any of them could happen, but they can't be predicted because it depends on the choices that we all make. Most people believe that it will be scenario number two. Things will just kind of slow down. It's a reasonable prognosis, and it may be the case. But it's also true that that's what most people always predict about the future, that we have maxed out, that it can't get any better, that the problems we face are too big. People have been saying this since Thomas Malthus in the 18th century, and Paul Ehrlich, who wrote in the 1960s about the population bomb and that we were going to face a massive famine in the 1970s. In the early 1990s, when the Cold War ended, almost everything that was written about developing countries is that they were going to lose because the stable world system was going to go away, that some of them were going to lose the foreign assistance, which frankly hadn't helped them much because it came through dictatorships. But if you look back to the early 1990s and people writing about the end of the Cold War, people said, this is going to hurt developing countries. It did just the opposite. When the HIV/AIDS crisis hit, everybody said development progress is going to slow. It was a horrible tragedy. It really was. But it did not stop overall progress, even in many of the countries hit. They're finally rebounding. When the Asian financial crisis hit, I worked on it a lot. I wrote a paper that my students read last week called Emerging Asia, and it came out, bad timing, 1997. It was written Emerging Asia, and people like Paul Krugman and others said that that we got it wrong, that the Asian miracle was over. No, it wasn't. It slowed down for a few years, but it came roaring back. After 9/11, people said development progress will slow down. After the world food crisis in 2007, it was supposed to be over. 100 million people were supposed to go back into poverty. It didn't happen. 2008 financial crisis, development progress was going to end. It didn't. So that doesn't mean that progress will continue, but it does mean that when people say, well, I'm skeptical that progress can continue, part of me thinks that's natural, and that's what everybody normally thinks, but it has not been the case. It's easy for us to see the big challenges that lie ahead, climate change, population growth. It's much harder always for us to see the human innovations that can come forward to help solve those problems, whether those innovations are technology, whether those innovations are in governance, innovations like democracy, which is an innovation. Innovations like the Global International System of Organizations, the United Nations, the WTO, the IMF, the World Bank. The United Nations is an audacious idea. It is an incredibly innovative idea. Just think of it, the idea that countries from around the world could come together and sit together and make decisions and have dialogue and actually get along with each other instead of shooting at each other. It's incredibly innovative. And as I say, audacious. It needs to be fixed, but that's an idea of innovation, and we're going to need more innovations like that in the years to come. So what do we need to happen? I think that continuing this progress is going to require changes in three areas, just like the progress so far required changes in three areas. One of them is global leadership. In the United States and Europe and Japan have a big role to play, to make steps that will be good for themselves, but will also set the stage for continued progress in the world's poorest countries. The United States needs to lead. We need to get our own economic house in order in terms of long-term issues around Social Security and the solvency of our fiscal system. I think some of the debate about immediate budget deficits is overstated, but the long-term issues around solvency and our own economic footing are important. We're going to need to need smart leadership in terms of democracy. If democracy is ever going to succeed in developing countries, they need to see that it works in the United States and in Europe. And right now, we are not exactly an inspiring model for how democracy is supposed to work. And this has knock-on implications, because developing countries see this. I have heard leaders in developing countries ask, what on earth was going on when we invaded Iraq? What on earth was going on in terms of Wall Street? What on earth is going on in terms of people not being able to recognize climate change? And so people wonder whether democracy can be as effective as we claim it will be. Because if we can't make it work for our problems, developing countries say, you know, maybe the Chinese model is actually an attractive one after all, because they get stuff done. So we're going to need to lead by example on democracy. We're going to need to lead on climate change. It's not going to get solved unless we take the lead. And we have seen in the last year, when the Obama administration worked with Chinese leadership on climate change, things can get done. That is an example of when we lead, things do get done. We're going to need, second, we're going to need deeper integration, global integration, and investments in technologies. It won't surprise you from what I've said that if we're going to solve these issues on climate change and on resource demand and on populations, we're going to need to continue to invest in technologies, green energy, desalinization of water, new high-yielding seeds and drought-resistant seed to fight the impacts of climate change, new communications technologies, and other kinds of technologies. Technology alone is not the answer, but in the absence of those technologies, in the absence of those changes, the world can't sustain 9 or 10 billion people. With changes in technologies and with changes in global governance, I think we can, but I'm not sure we'll get there. And then the third piece is leadership in developing countries. This starts and ends in terms of the decisions that people make in developing countries. There's much better leadership today. There's much more effective leadership. That leadership needs to be translated into better institutions with more permanent norms and ideas. And that's going to take sacrifice and investment and courage in developing countries to make their legal systems work better, to make the economic decisions to diversify and have more inclusive economies, and to build their governance systems and invest in health and continue to invest in health and education and infrastructure. None of this is going to be easy. This is a really ambitious agenda, but it's never easy. It's never easy. And when I think back to where we were 70 years ago, coming out of World War II, and the progress that has been made, and if anyone would have laid out the agenda then of what we needed to do, you would have said we were crazy. You're crazy. We need to end Nazism and fascism. We need to develop our scientific technology so that we can carry around supercomputers in our pocket and communicate with each other. We need to bring an end to the Soviet Union and the Cold War without launching World War III. We need to end and eradicate smallpox. We need to almost eradicate polio. We need to set up an institution like the United Nations and other institutions so that we actually can work together and bring peace to many parts of the world. We need to have things like the Green Revolution that can double agricultural output in Asia and feed an entire continent that looked like it was on the edge of starvation. We need to develop vaccines so that 17% of children live instead of dying. We need to have access to water and sanitation. We did all that. It's been done. And the agenda going forward is no more ambitious than what has been accomplished over the last 60 or 70 years. It's a matter of choice. None of these outcomes are fated. I am certain that we have the skills, we have the brains, we have the resources, we have everything we need to make the choices and to get this done. I'm absolutely certain of that. I'm not at all certain that we're going to make the choices and have the courage and the leadership to make the investments and make this happen. That's the big question. Georgetown has a big role to play in this in terms of our teaching, our courses, working with our alumni who are in many positions of leadership, and our research, and researching into issues around global institutions and how they need to be remade for the years to come. We have a big role to play. So the challenge then for all of us is to make these changes happen in terms of technological advances, in terms of innovations in governance, in terms of not just figuring out what the solutions are, but actually bringing them to happen. Those are big challenges. The stakes are really high, not just for the world's poorest countries, but for the rich countries as well. But I do believe that the opportunity is within our grasp in the years to come to further reduce poverty, to expand the reach of development and personal freedoms, and to continue to improve health and education around the world. It's an opportunity that we must seize. Thank you very much for your attention. Mm-hmm. I think you're in this one.
Okay, great. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Steve, for an excellent presentation and an exciting book.
Thank you.
I hope everyone's getting their copy. I understand you're going to be available later to sign mm-hmm. copies
yep.
of the book. It's great having you here. It's wonderful to have this discussion as part of the series of on global futures. Look, you've given us a kind of exhilarating panorama of the last 25 years. It's almost leaves one breathless. But let me start with a question.
Good.
How do we miss this?
It's a good question. So, first, just to reinforce that point, a Swedish group, Novus, did a survey 2 years ago and asked Americans a number of questions. But one of the questions was a multiple choice question about what had happened to the share of people living in extreme poverty around the world over the last 20 years. Defined extreme poverty question was share. What had happened to the share? Answer A was the share of people living in extreme poverty had doubled in the last 20 years, which is actually not quite mathematically impossible, but almost, because it would have had to have been pretty low. But anyway, 66% of Americans answered A. The share of people living in poverty had doubled. Answer B, the share has not changed in the last 20 years. 29% of Americans checked that box. We're at 95%. Only 5% knew or guessed the right answer that the share had fallen in half. So it's people don't know the basics, and people, of course, don't know the health and comfort. So why is that? I think it's a couple different things. One is we are very attracted to bad news that happens overnight. We're for very good reasons, obviously, attracted to what's going on with the tragedy in Paris. We're attracted to plane crashes. We're attracted to war, all for good reasons. And it's not that those things don't deserve our attention. But we are not attracted in the newspapers to stories of Ghana growing by 6% a year over 20 years, and a peaceful transfer of power makes page 18. It's just not the kind of things that people read. So part of it is our attention in the press, and I think part of it is the press and the stories that they lead with, but part of it is human attention. So I think that's part of it. But I also think part of it is even for professionals in development, I think sometimes we get so focused in our own area of discipline that we don't know what's going on in other areas. So even within development professionals, when I talk to people who work on poverty, they know all about the poverty numbers, and they're absolutely stunned about the conflict numbers. People who work in health know all about the health numbers, but really don't know much about the democracy numbers. So part of it is that even amongst professionals, we get pretty narrow, and we kind of miss the big picture.
Well, I think one of the issues that we also need to be thinking about is, as you said, why and what are the factors, so we can mm-hmm. learn from those factors right. In order to extend it. And you, in your presentation and in the book, you place a lot of emphasis on leadership.
Yep.
And leadership is one of those indefinable components. We know it when we see it. We appreciate it when it's there. But thinking about that as some systematic explanatory factor
yep.
that leads to a global change.
Right.
I mean, what would explain why do you think that we're getting a better crop of leaders? Is there something more fundamental going on globally or institutionally
yeah.
that's leading to better leaders? And what role, and you continue to say, leadership will play in this?
Yeah, so I think it starts with ideas around where progress has been happening. Ideas in particular around democratic governance, liberal democracy, and around market capitalism. And the ideas in developing countries changed quite a bit over the years. But in the 1990s, several forces came together where leaders grabbed those ideas and moved forward with them. And the big ideas in the 60s and 70s had been around state control, both politically and economically. That had been justified because of centuries of abuse, frankly, under colonial rule, where the Western powers installed authoritarian governments and extractive businesses that took the resources away. We created models that the post-independence leaders followed up on. That was the main idea, and of course that was supported by the ideas around socialism and communism, that state control was the best recipe. Over the 70s and 80s, that fell more and more into disrepute, and more emerging leaders came up in developing countries that said those ideas are wrong, we need a new idea. I actually think there's a big reason for this is a generation had changed from post-independence in the 1960s, the independence movements in the 60s and 70s, to the early 90s. It was a new generation, and I think to some extent you actually need to wait that generation for the old folks to move on, the old men, and they were almost all men, to move on, and a new generation to come up and say, we need to go in a different direction. That was coupled with the opportunity because of the end of the Cold War that created the opportunity actually for new people to come to the fore, and many citizen groups rose and threw out the old guys and new leaders could come to the fore. So I think it really does start with individual leaders, and that's happened in many of our own countries where key leaders made decisions at critical times. Nelson Mandela in South Africa made key decisions about being one term and about having a truth and justice commission rather than a tribunal. You know, key decisions that individuals make. The trick then becomes for those individual leaders to move towards institutionalizing these new ideas. And if it continues to rely on just individuals, it's not going to happen, because sooner or later you're going to get a bad individual out there. The key thing is whether those individuals that have taken leadership roles in political systems and business and everything else create the rules and the norms and the ideas to institutionalize that citizens can choose their own leaders, to institutionalize rule of law, to institutionalize property rights, to institutionalize norms around equal rights. And again, it often takes a generation for those norms to become accepted more widely. And if that happens, then you can begin to have this progress continue over a long time. So I think it was individuals rising up, the opportunity that was created by the end of the Cold War, but then those individuals moving to institutionalize the changes.
Yeah, I want to ask you a follow-up on the question of norms, because I think that's, to me, one of the most interesting strands mm-hmm. that comes throughout this whole story, which is that one of the things you can say about the end of the Cold War is that it changed the whole normative dimension of what the feasible or range of set of choices would be about policies and institutions. Mm-hmm. That had a major change in norms. A new set of leaders who contributed to a different set of norms. But also, as you say, global integration. And when we think about global integration, we think not only of economic and political ties, but we think of the spread of global norms that come from that. You know, it gets to the question when we think about development, and I'll start to ask about development assistance, that we focus a lot on building stuff and, you know, providing support for governments. Right. But this other role of spreading norms, whether it's norms of what constitute the range of macroeconomic policies, which were very, very different 20 years ago as they are now, the norms about good governance, what constitutes good governance, the norms of what responsibility for governments are for providing basic sort of services, whether these things are more powerful than anything we might build, because essentially it sets up a wider environment for leaders and citizens to come in and push these developments.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think they are more powerful in the long run. But sometimes you need the stuff or the immediate results in order to reinforce the building of the norms. So, for example, if people are going to believe that liberal democracy is going to work, it needs to deliver the goods. They need to see that people have access to vaccines for their children and bed nets, and that schools get built and teachers show up, and roads are built and power lines are built. So delivering the goods can reinforce the norms and the structures around governance. So I don't think it means that we abandon those things, but I do think it means that we have the courage to stand up and work on these other dimensions as well. This is where diplomacy becomes such a big part, I think, of what we do. Sometimes it has been used for the wrong purposes, but when used for the best, our diplomats work with people from developing countries, show examples, stand with them, as John Kerry did in Tunisia. A perfect example on Friday, John Kerry was in Tunisia standing with the new democratically elected government of Tunisia. And that provides big support back home to help solidify those norms. It happens through exchange programs, scholarship programs, where foreign students come to the United States or Europe. It happens, you won't be surprised that I make a pitch here for the Peace Corps. I have some bias. But those kinds of citizen exchange programs help create that exchange of norms and those ideas. So we need the stuff, but we also need to do a much better job, I think, the United States does and Europe does, of enlarging our diplomatic presence and what is often called the soft tools, the tools of soft power, to help encourage the building of those norms over time. And the norms and the delivering of the goods, the delivering of the progress that people want, can get into a self-reinforcing positive cycle.
Well, let's talk about the delivery of the goods, because one, you know, when you talk about people's perceptions of poverty reduction, if you ask people about the effectiveness of assistance and development assistance to help build the goods, if you will, the perceptions of how well development assistance has performed over the course of the last 25 years in achieving these outcomes, any public opinion poll that you'd put out would show very, very low. In the U.S. in particular, we almost seem to be at a sense of almost stalemate, fatigue, about the discussion of where to go on development assistance and whether development assistance is getting any outcomes.
Yep.
And as you very well know, a Nobel Prize winner, whose name we shall
we can now,
but Nobel Prize winner Angus Deaton,
and a well-deserved Nobel
whose
Prize,
whose book, in terms of measuring our advance on global poverty outcomes, has also been a tremendous boost to our thinking about the progress that's been made over the last 25 years and longer. He takes a very long view. But oddly enough, his conclusion, as you know, in that book, when he discusses the role of foreign assistance in that sweep of history, he comes out very negative and in fact dismisses the role of foreign assistance and says this is largely done outside of the foreign assistance realm. Mm-hmm. So what's your thoughts and how do you differ from his views and the impact of that?
So first of all, he deserved the Nobel Prize richly for his work on consumption, on household surveys, for the work that he's done on savings and other things. He didn't do any work, any research actually on foreign aid, so it wasn't on that. And he has admitted, actually, in a couple of interviews that what he has said about foreign aid is grounded in his opinions rather than in research. But here's where I think the evidence stacks up on foreign assistance. First of all, it has not been the major driver of this success. I mentioned it fourth, and I think I mentioned it in about two sentences. It is a, I believe the evidence shows, a secondary positive force behind these global changes, global leadership in the end of the Cold War, behind global integration and the spread of technologies, behind leadership and courageous decisions in developing countries. So this is not a story that foreign aid is the big driving force. That's not true. But especially in the last 25 years, since the end of the Cold War, most research evidence does point to positive impacts from foreign aid in this, most clearly around health. And when Professor Deaton or Bill Easterly or Dambisa Moyo, any of the skeptics are challenged, they all backpedal fast when faced with the evidence on health. And that a large portion of aid goes to health. It has literally saved, literally, millions of lives in terms of child vaccinations, in terms of fighting malaria. Malaria deaths are down by half in the last 15 years, down by half. Deaths from tuberculosis are down by a third. Deaths from HIV/AIDS are down by a third. Foreign aid was a big part of those kinds of advances. So in health, I don't think there's actually no dispute. In terms of, in other places, agricultural technology, the Green Revolution that fed millions of people was financed by a lot of foreign assistance. And more recently, there's also been new advances in sorghum and cassava and continuing new varieties in rice and other advances in agriculture where there's also a consensus around those improvements. The bigger debates are around the impact on economic growth and the impacts on political systems. The evidence on economic growth is mixed, but more and more of the research in the last few years finds a modest positive impact of foreign aid on growth. Lots of countries where it's failed, but more and more countries like South Korea and Taiwan, but also Botswana and Rwanda and Mozambique and Liberia more recently, where aid has had a positive impact. Most of the results show a statistically significant impact of about 1 percentage point adding to growth. Still lots of disputes. It's not open and shut, but that's what most of the research evidence says. And then finally, in terms of democracy, there's a lot of debate about whether aid undermines democratic institutions or not. And Professor Deaton and Bill Easterly and others claim that it undermines it because we support dictatorships, which of course we have done in the past. And there was no help to democracy when we supported Mobutu and Marcos and others, and we still do some of that today. But again, the research evidence, most of it in the last few years, has shown that since the end of the Cold War, aid has helped consolidate democratic transitions, both because of helping the progress in health and growth, but also more and more aid donors are standing with civil society in terms of encouraging democracy. And I'll give you one example. In Senegal, President Wade, a few years ago, two-term president, wanted to run for a third term. Civil society groups in Senegal said no, 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 but it looked like he was going to ram it through anyway. The international community stood with civil society groups and said no third term. And then Wade basically tried to hand over to resign and then give power to his son. And again, civil society groups said no, and the international community stood with them. And in the end, they had to stand back, let elections happen. An opposition candidate, Macky Sall, was elected, and it's a good example of how, done correctly, donor groups can help support transitions to democracy. So lots of debate, but I think if you really look at the evidence, it's certainly not slam dunk negative impact. It just does not say that. It is much more mixed, but most of the evidence pointing to a positive income, especially in the last 20 years.
Okay, I'm going to open it up in a second for questions, but I just want to put one last question to you while mm-hmm. others are kind of composing theirs, which is that the remaining, the last mile, if you will, we're talking now about the fragile and conflict-affected states. We're yep. talking about excluded regions or excluded populations.
Right.
To what extent is the last mile of poverty reduction fundamentally different than the trends that you've been looking at over the last 25 years, which would require some maybe fundamentally new approach to thinking about how you reach that last.
Yeah, they are much different, and you're asking me, but you actually know more about this than I do, although I've worked in some failed and fragile states as well. But You know, people talk about the elimination or the eradication of extreme poverty in the next 20 years. And as much as I like an optimistic view of the world, I don't think it's going to happen, actually. Because getting there and continuing, getting anywhere close to zero, means not just continuing progress in China and in India and in Brazil and in Indonesia and in Mozambique and all the countries that are moving generally in the right direction. That's going to be hard enough. If we do that, we'll probably get down to 400 million, 300 million people living in poverty. The real trick is that it's going to take a fundamental change in direction in Somalia and in Congo and in North Korea and in many other places, in many of the stans in Central Asia and in the Central African Republic. And I'm not sure that's going to happen anytime soon. And so how the world can bring about changes in those countries is a big challenge. And I'm not going to pretend that I know some simple answer to that, other than the power of example and the power of progress in other countries. I do believe that the more that other countries succeed, the more pressure builds on the countries that are not succeeding. When I worked in Africa in the 1980s, often it was like, well, everything fails in Africa, which was always pretty sobering. Now there's more and more, well, Ghana's doing it, why can't we? I work a lot in Liberia, and they ask a lot, what did Ghana do on this situation, or what did Mozambique do after the war ended? I saw that in Asia when I worked in Indonesia. The Indonesians always wanted to know what the Koreans had done, and the Taiwanese had done, and the Singaporeans had done. The positives of examples spread. So, you know, when I think about Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe, it's going to get worse before it gets better, I'm afraid. But I also think that I think there are limits to what outsiders can do in a place like Zimbabwe. We can provide some help to social progress and social safety nets on health and education. We can't really invest heavily in economic growth. It's not going to happen while he's in charge. I think we can provide some safety nets, but I don't think we can think that we can in any way go in and intervene. It doesn't work. But I do think that we can help other countries that are providing examples that eventually, at some point, when the right leaders have the opportunity, they can move in Zimbabwe and say, hey, if other countries around here are progressing, our people deserve the same. So, but I'd be curious what your answer to that that good question is as well.
Well, look, we're going to take some questions from the floor. We've got a microphone. We're taping it, so please use the microphones. And if you can, identify yourself and ask your question. Jim.
Hi, Steve. Thank you so much for this very inspiring talk. Let me give you a problem though, because
just one.
The measures you
Jim still
lay
wants
out,
to, you know, be in the dean's office and give me problems to deal with.
The measures you lay out are almost all material improvements mm-hmm. in standard of living, longer mm-hmm. births, longer life, and so forth. And I would say there was a consensus during the Cold War that was the goal. Mm-hmm. And even if you look at the most dysfunctional efforts, like you take Mao Zedong's Great Leap Forward, Mao was trying to increase the welfare. He wasn't trying to undermine people. We got an awful lot of people wandering around the world today who just don't share those basic norms, those mm-hmm. basic values. They don't think that improving these measures of life is the point of the whole thing. Mm-hmm. We just saw them in Paris. How do we get on track in the future if we've got a lot of people who just don't share the basic objective that you described?
So it's a good question. And I actually thought you were going to say something else. We'd go from the material into the governance structures. But let me bring in governance, because you did talk about some of the material improvements. But one of the things that I do stress that it has also improvements in governance and freedom and people's ability to express themselves, to hold their leaders accountable, and to move towards something around the norms of what we call liberal democracy, even if it's not exactly the same. And I focus on that because I actually believe, I really do deeply believe, that the vast majority of people in the world share those values, whether it's in terms of material progress or in terms of around personal freedoms and openness. And I came to really believe this when I lived in Indonesia in the early 90s, and I was told by so many people, well, the Indonesians actually only care about material progress. They only care about jobs. Suharto's fine. They don't really care about democracy. It turned out that was wrong, actually. When Suharto got sick and then died, it turned out that Indonesians wanted not just material progress, They wanted to be able to pick their leaders and hold them accountable. They wanted something like democracy. And everything I had been told in the 90s by the political elite on that score was wrong. So I've come to believe that these are not Western values, that at some core that they are human values in terms of wanting to better yourselves, your family, your children, and to have an opportunity for better health, for better education, and some freedom to do what you want to do. Having said that, there are a minority of people that do not share this view, that want power, that want their own views imposed on everyone else, and are willing to do the most extreme and awful acts to get there. This is not new. It has gone back from the beginning of human history. We just have seen the most recent ugly form of it on Friday night in Paris. I don't claim to know the answers to this, except similar to what my answer to Joel in the last one. I think what we can do is stand tall for the values that we believe in and to help other developing countries who do believe in those values to also stand tall, that we will stand with them and they will stand with us. And the bigger the international community that begins to have the ability to stand up for those values, I think as a world we're in a better position to fight back. I think that's a large part of the history over the last 60 or 70 years since the end of World War II. We're far from being there yet, and it is true that a small minority of people can wreck this. But I think the more that we can build the capacities and ideas and progress in other countries, the better off in terms of fighting that small minority.
Please.
Hi, thank you for an amazing talk. My name is Mohammed. I'm a junior from SFSQ. And my question to you would be that we see this rising cultural tension in the globe. You have Europe and the West, in the US, you have this surge of nationalism coming back, you have problems in democracy and capitalism themselves, and in the other part of the world, you have extremism, you have this growing sense of civilization, whether it's China or South Asia or the Middle East. Yeah. So how do you see these cultural civilizational tensions affecting international cooperation, global cooperation, whether it's through international organizations, whether it's just through country-country relationships themselves?
Right. So it's a big challenge. And thank you for coming from SFSQ, coming all that way just for my talk. I really, I appreciate that, especially since it's being filmed. You could have just, anyway. But it's actually, it's a great example of globalization that we have that relationship with SFSQ. It's a good question. Here's my answer to this. When the United Nations was established in the late 40s, we invited into that organization our absolute sworn enemies of Germany and Japan, which now seems obvious, but was not so obvious at the time. Countries that we, at the time, felt the majority of people had completely different views, fundamentally opposing views. How could we ever work with them? And we did. China has become a big member and an important member of the United Nations and needs to play a more important role. I think the history over the last few decades is that when we work in a cooperative way, recognizing our differences and not just falling down, but actually negotiating and respecting other people's views and where they come from, we have found that actually we can make progress together. And we have done it through these international organizations that do bring people from very different cultures, very different ideas, and that jointly with lots of problems and lots of mistakes and lots of waste and lots of going the wrong way, stumble sometimes forward. And the fact that we did that when the world was facing much deeper crises, I think, than we face today, actually, coming out of that war, and the future was really uncertain, we had the courage to do that and to invite our enemies into the same institutions and find out that decades later, they're not our enemies. We've learned from them, they learned from us, and we work together to make the world a better place. I've watched carefully United States relationships with Indonesia. I mean, they couldn't be more different in terms of the histories, the cultures, the ideas, the languages, and everything else. Not the closest of friends, but actually working cooperatively together on a range of different issues. And so we've done it before. And so that gives me the optimism that we can continue to do it, even though I don't want to suggest that this is all easy and a bed full of roses. But because we have invited our enemies into these institutions and it has worked, I think that provides the basis where we can continue to do this, whether they're enemies or just different cultures, to bring people together in a stronger set of institutions. I actually do think one of the biggest challenges for the next 30 years is to remake those international institutions and organizations in a way that catches up with the reality of China and India and Indonesia and Brazil and South Africa being big players in the world. They did not have a big part in the original concepts of those institutions. They need to play a bigger role now. And one of the great challenges which this university can play a big role in is how we reshape those international institutions in the future to bring those countries in a better way so that we can collectively fight the challenges on climate change and terrorism and everything else.
Let me take one last question in the back.
Thank you. Irene Jolson, professor from School of Nursing and Health Studies at Georgetown. So in the last 25 years, among the many things that has happened, has been an extraordinary investment in science diplomacy,
yes,
including but not limited to investments in infrastructure, training, education, development of biomedical researchers.
Yes.
And there's been a commensurate increase in collaborative research, both South-South and between developed and developing countries. And I wonder if you can comment on the degree to which you believe this science diplomacy, these advances in science and technology, have contributed to the improvements that you've seen.
So I'm certain that science has contributed a lot to this progress. How much of that was science diplomacy? It's a really good question, and I'm not sure, because I haven't actually thought about it that much through that lens. But I would be astonished if it was not a big part of it. And, you know, I think a lot about the Green Revolution, actually, and the scientific research that went behind that, which actually is an excellent example of science diplomacy, and some of the work that has gone on in vaccines and other health advances that actually did take a big cooperative effort. And so although I didn't look through it exactly through that lens, I suspect that it has been a big part. But I'm looking forward, I'm certain that this is going to be a big part of the future. If we're going to make the technological advances that I've been talking about, we need to be able to work with Chinese scientists and Indian scientists and South African scientists to build their capacity, but also ours, so that we get ideas from them, because there's a lot of smart people working on similar issues that we need to learn from, but also to make those solutions so that they are applicable in those countries. This is going to take money. It's going to take investing in research and science diplomacy. It's going to take money investing in research for new types of agricultural high-yielding seeds and drought-resistant seeds. It's going to take money to invest in green technology, alternative sources of fuel. We know that. It's going to take money to invest in desalinization. This is not going to be easy. It cannot be done on the cheap. And if we make those investments, I think we've got the brains to work together in science diplomacy with people around the world to find solutions to these problems. I'm not sure we're going to make that sacrifice. It is going to take money. It's going to take resources. It's going to take people. It's going to take cooperation. But I think we can do it.
We're going to have time to continue the conversation over refreshments, as I understand it. So let me invite Tom up just to let us know what the next step is and take it from there.
I think you've said it all there, Joel. Basically, we're cutting this conversation short. In the president's room, we've got refreshments. There'll be a book signing. The books are available at a discount. So we invite you to join us. Thank you all for coming. And in conclusion, please join me in again thanking Steve and Joel.
Thank you.